Yo. What up, chat? What up, fam? What's going on? Got a little bit of the sickness still lingering, man. My voice is going a little bit in and out, but we'll be okay. I think it's just the process of me waking up this morning, so we'll be all right. It's getting better. It's been getting better as I've been waking up and getting ready, so we'll be all right. It's good to see you guys. Happy Sunday, man. I hope everybody's having a good weekend. I don't know. We saw a few cool things out of the IGN FanFest stuff. There was a lot of filler crap out of the IGN FanFest stuff. As far as I'm concerned, there might be people out there that really enjoyed it, but I mean, we watched roughly like a little bit over 6 hours worth of content over the past 2 days from the IGN FanFest stuff. Man, it was a lot of crap filler, dude. There was a lot of IGN commercials that were just repeated over and over and over, and they were pretty cringy. So that was really rough to like sit through, and then a lot of like interview process that was just boring to me. It could have been more streamlined. It could have been a smaller. It could have been one day of production, really, where they went, hey, we've got more interview with the actors and actresses from this production. Check out our website for more on-demand video of our interview process with, you know, instead of like everything they showed. I don't know. It was weird, man. It was just, I mean, dude, I was ready to fall asleep, man, on stream watching this thing. It was kind of brutal. I think, it kind of showed to me, and people would just constantly like be falling out of the stream too. It was not very fun content. Everybody wants to see like what's coming as far as game stuff, and some of the like movie stuff's cool because there's like video game adaptations they're talking about, or cool movies that a lot of people are into, like John Wick stuff or whatever. But then there's a lot that's just like, bleh. It was kind of weird. So today, man, we'll be back into video gaming news as always, which we do every day, right? So we'll do video gaming news, and then we'll do day two of Once Human. We got through like the first part of the tutorial yesterday, and we just kind of hit the open world where we need to start making a base. We've got to start collecting loot. We've got to start putting talent points in. They call them meta points, or meme points, not meta points. They call your characters are like metas or whatever, but you got these memetics. Are what like all the talents and everything are called, so you get meme points put in. And we're starting that whole process. The game felt pretty good yesterday. I've been making an entire list of pros and cons so that we can provide a nice comprehensive feedback for the devs as far as the things that we're finding to be very good and things that maybe need a little bit more work before they go full release on the game. But I'm enjoying the process. I like doing betas. I like providing feedback. We'll keep doing it today, man. We'll get day two in. Cool. So on that note, it's good to see you guys again. And let's go ahead and get into the news, baby. Let's go. First and foremost, before we get in all the way, Crypt of the NecroDancer vibes, that's what we're listening to this morning. Rhythm-based adventure RPG. Notorious for being a very good rhythm-based game. Go check it out. The soundtrack's amazing too. That's what we're listening to this morning. So go give it a shot. If you're enjoying the music this morning, go check out the OST. I know the OST that you buy on Steam is extensive. Just what you see here is what we're listening to this morning. It's like 43 songs. But it ends up having, if you buy it on Steam, I know you get like roughly 6 other soundtracks that come along with it based off of the original Crypt of the NecroDancer OST. That are like remixes of chopped versions, all kinds of like synthwave stuff. There's all kinds of crazy stuff that comes with it. So go check it out. It's good stuff. On that note, we'll kill the music. Let's get into the news. Let's go. I need lots of coffee this morning. Lots of the coffee, man. Lots of the coffee. Yeah, yeah. Excuse me. Steam sale makes a bunch of games just $1. We'll take a look, see what's going on there. Switch sales making over 30 games just 99 cents each. We've already talked about this. Ubisoft's making this police alert system to fight toxicity and like abuse in their games, which is great. I've dogged on Ubi a lot here lately just because as a dev, they've been, you know, really trudging through. They've had a hard time of late, and it's been very, very noticeable, you know, and not just of late. I mean, over the past few years, we've seen a decline in who they are as a developer. The kind of content they're bringing to the table, it's stuff like that. I've talked about it enough, but there's something to be said for developers that have a focus on trying to maintain healthy communities and get rid of toxicity, especially trying to really track down, you know, perpetrators within the community that are going to great, you know, lengths to try to get people to maybe do things like harm themselves, things like that. So good on Ubi. We've talked about it, though. We hit on this about, I don't know, almost a week ago in the news segment. So I'm not going to dive back into it right now, but good on Ubi, man. It's really good stuff. Game Pass subscribers losing access to one of the biggest series in gaming. That's all the once human stuff. I'll look at that after the news. New Lord of the Rings games teased. Take a peek. We've already kind of talked about what's coming for Lord of the Rings. There's about 3 to 4 games we're already aware of. Another one that we're not quite sure what it's going to be. But let's see what they've got here for us. How to play Diablo 4 early. I'll pull that up, see if we can get anybody in that's interested. PlayStation goggles are a win for gamers, huh? Let's see. New Pokemon Mystery Dungeon game for Switch. Things drop like candy, man. It's because they sell. Ubisoft will reportedly revive a neglected franchise, huh? Dead Rising 5 gameplay and details leak online. This is probably some of the stuff we have up already. The Batman games are on sale on Steam right now. The Arkham Knight series. I'm sure that's what they're talking about. As well as probably some, like maybe the Telltale series, stuff like that. But we've got something up about a lot of Steam sales, so I'm guessing they'll be in that. New PlayStation freebie available for PS4 and PS5. Let's see what's going on. right, let's go into our other search here. We've got a good amount of articles for a Sunday. Man. We actually watched something on the Super Nintendo World theme park at Universal. We watched something on it yesterday. I mean, I understand why this is maybe grabs people at some people's attention, especially a younger audience. Go, I want to go to Super Nintendo World. I mean, I can only imagine how much money you spend to just go to spend like one day there, though. You know. For like a family of maybe like four, it's gonna be a lot. It's one of those things that turns me off about a lot of that stuff. It's like, just go spend a single day doing something like that. It's an incredible amount of money. When you could just like take that money, buy yourself a Switch and a few games, and just immerse yourself in some Mario World on on a console, dude. I don't know. That's just my take, though. I mean, anytime you go to a place like this, it's everything involved. The food's crazy expensive because you can't bring food or drinks in, right? The food and even water is stupid, like, because they don't hardly ever put any like water fountains in anymore or anything. It's like you gotta buy bottled water, and it's crazy expensive. So food and drink is expensive, and just getting in is expensive, and you know, it's just kind of wild for like half a day of just going to like check out what the park's going to be about, you know? It's kind of nuts. And then they'll have other gimmicks inside. It's like, oh, I think they have like something like, oh, pay $40, you know what I mean? Pay $40 and you get like Nintendo mushroom like slap bracelet, dude. And whenever you go through some of the areas, you can like swipe it and you'll get like a little hologram type thing that'll show up. They were even talking about it yesterday on IGN FanFest that it wasn't even really worth, you know, but there's like all kinds of gimmicks like that. It's like $40, dog. And it's like just to use it through the park for the day. You know what I mean? It's kind of crazy, man. But look, to each their own. That's just my take. Bro, let's go. Remake Def Jam Fight for New York? Bro, let's go. I am so ready. I loved that game, dude. Me and my boy, I was calling my brother. Dude is like my brother, man. His family is like my family. And that was our jam, dude, way back in the day. Def Jam Fight for New York was our jam, dude. Sick soundtrack. A lot of cool characters, plus making your own character, and a lot of cool mechanics for a fighting game, man. You know, again, like you basically creating your character and going through and fighting a bunch of like renowned like rappers and R&B stars and stuff like that. You know what I mean? I can't even remember who all was in the game at this point, but dude, it was so good. Come on in, buddy. What's up? What's up, gamer? How you doing? Pokemon Scarlet and Violet leak reveals unused content. Interesting. Happy Sunday, buddy. How are you, man? Just woke up. I haven't been awake. I've only been awake for about an hour, dude. I slept in this morning. Looks like they've got 5 hours of leaked gameplay footage from Atomic
Comic art. Yeah. Yeah, there'll be spoilers in here and stuff. Is this from, I wonder what platform this is on. Yeah, it looks like somebody got a hold of a copy early. So I'm guessing it's probably not the PC version, I would assume. I could be wrong. But this got streamed. About 5 hours of it got streamed. We'll look at it. We'll see. I'm not gonna watch any of it, but we'll look at that article. That's always a risk for developers, man. People get their hands on it early. And it gets streamed. Happens all the time. Yeah, we saw some of that already. Cosmic Horror FPS Quantum Error, huh? Let's take a look at that. What is this? Rainbow Six Siege reveals Season 1 for Year 8. New operator and features. We'll take a quick peek. I got a lot of stuff this morning, man. I don't know if I agree. The addition of Game Boy Advance games makes the Nintendo Switch a necessity. No. There are other ways you can go about playing Game Boy Advance games. Nintendo's kind of a butthole about stuff, so I'm not real... You know, I'm glad they're doing this. I think it's great that they're finally starting to give people access to older titles and stuff, but it doesn't make the Switch a necessity. There are other ways to go about getting old games played. Look into it. Yeah, there are a lot of ways to make there's hardware out there to play old cartridges. There's ways to emulate old systems. I mean, you name it. If it wasn't for the ways that we had to emulate old systems and play those old games already, dude, we would have lost so much gaming history. And thankfully, there's a huge community out there that's committed to not letting that history in gaming die, because the developers themselves, like Nintendo, they don't care much outside of trying to make money off of it. We've already got Dead Rising 5 stuff up, so I'm not going to look at that. Good news for Game Pass users, huh? Let's see what that is. This site, we've already got open beta stuff up. Try to get people info on how to get in on that. Layers of Fear stuff. We saw this yesterday. So I'm not going to look at that. We saw a video of the new Layers of Fear stuff yesterday and the IGN stuff. So I'm not going to dive in that. We've already hit on this in the news too, so I won't dive in there. Let's see with this. There's a lot of articles, man. You guys ready? You guys ready? You just hang out, drink some coffee, and let me soothe you with my voice while we do this new stuff, okay? Let's do this. Good news for Game Pass users. Microsoft continues to maintain its success in game consoles with the Game Pass subscription service. The American technology giant will add 6 new games to its Game Pass library in February. One of these games, Mountain Blade Bannerlord, is already available to subscribers. According to the company's announcement, Madden 23, Gundam Battle Alliance. Hold on. There we go. Games like City Skylines Remastered, Shadow Warrior 3 Definitive Edition, and Atomic Heart will also be included in the Game Pass library by the end of this month. The minimum and recommended system requirements of these games, which will attract the attention of gamers, has also been announced. Minimum requirements for the operating system is Windows 7. And the recommended requirement is Windows 10. Dude, how long ago did they quit supporting Windows 7, though? Really? They'll still put out, Microsoft will still put out, like, the minimum requirement as an OS of Windows 7, even though they quit supporting that platform? I didn't know that. By quit supporting, that means that they don't actually continue to push out updates for it and stuff. When do they quit supporting? When was the end of life? Yeah. End of support day for Windows 7 was January 14th of 2020. That was like 3 years ago, man. And they'll still actually, they still list it as, like, minimum requirements? It's crazy. I guess they kind of have to. I can understand that to an extent, but, bro, if you're running Windows 7 right now on a network-connected machine, let me tell you what. If you're running Windows 7 on a network-connected machine, which if you fall into this window of a minimum recommended system, you running 95. I wish I was, dog. Windows 95 was a beast. Windows 95 was OG best Windows, dog. You know what I mean? Give me some of that solitaire, brother. You know what I'm talking about? Give me some of that Minesweeper, bro. What's up, dude? Windows 95 was great, dude. I'll take it. Funny enough, dude, I worked in an IT section where they were still running laptops. They were still running laptops, dude, with Windows 95 on them. Was it Windows 95 or XP? It's been a while now. But this was not a significant amount. I'm talking about half a decade ago, probably. They were running a Windows 95 or Windows XP. I think it was 95. And they were running this operating system about half a decade, about 5 years ago, probably. Maybe a little bit more than that. But it was around there. On these laptops that wouldn't get connected to a network, so understand that. These were never connected to a network at all. They were used to console into network devices to maintain them and stuff. I was like, my mind was blown, dude. I could not believe it. I was like, what? That was crazy, dude. It was really nuts. Went downhill from there. They've had some bad ones, dude. Like Windows 8, holy crap. And Vista, Windows Vista and Windows 8 were just terrible, dude. But 7 was really good. I like 7 a lot. Windows 7 was really good. I've enjoyed Windows 10 quite a bit, too. Windows 10's been pretty nice, which is what's made me scared about Windows 11. Because it's kind of gotten into that groove where it's like, good, bad, good, bad. It's like a roller coaster, dude. You're like hitting these like peaks and like huge peaks and low valleys for the Windows operating systems, where it's one's really good and the next one will be like really bad. That's kind of the way it's felt for a while. So Windows 11's got me a bit scared, but this is crazy to me, you know, that they're like the minimum requirement for an operating system is Windows 7, when they legit quit servicing this operating system over 3 years ago now. Meaning that anybody that is actually utilizing a computer with an operating system of Windows 7 is having significant vulnerabilities, but it's going to be attached to a network if they're in this conversation here, because they're trying to play games on Game Pass with it. That's crazy, dude. Yo, what? Did I just get hacked because I'm talking about Windows? Okay. I just got hacked. Hacker mans. Plug your internet. Dude, that's the first thing I did. I looked at OBS. I was like, dude, did my internet just crash? But it was fine. I was like, Wick hacked me, dude. Moreover, Intel Core i3-8100 or Ryzen 3-1200 processor, 6 gigs of memory, NVIDIA GeForce GTX 660 or an AMD Radeon HD 7850 video card and 60 gigs of storage space were determined as minimum system requirements. Recommended system requirements are an Intel i5-9600 or a Ryzen 5-3600X processor, 8 gigs of memory, NVIDIA GeForce 1060 or a Radeon 580 graphics card, and 60 gigs of storage. Microsoft Game Pass continues to offer a wide choice to its subscribers by adding new games to its library regularly. Xbox console owners have the opportunity to play thousands of games without limits thanks to its service. Also includes PC and cloud gaming. Game Pass Ultimate with a subscription. Users can play the games on the device they want. In this way, gamers can play the game they want whenever they want, at home or outside. Or even outside and in your home if your home is outside. Ooh. Mind blown. Microsoft continues to win the hearts of gamers by bringing a whole new dimension to the gaming world with its Game Pass subscription service. Nice. Yeah. That's crazy, though. I'm really surprised that for PC, they're still saying Windows 7. 3 years after they quit supporting that OS. Pretty nuts. Here you go. Cosmic horror FPS Quantum Error reveals third-person gameplay in new trailer. Today, developer Team Kill Media released another brand new teaser trailer of its cosmic horror game Quantum Error. Wick, how you been, buddy? How you doing, dude? No troll. Kayla, what's up, my friend? How are you today? If you've read the title, you may be a bit confused, wondering how a first-person shooter can have third-person gameplay. No, they've done that a lot. It's pretty easy to explain. While the developers define Quantum Error as a first-person shooter, they have decided to include the ability to switch to third-person at will during gameplay. With a couple of exceptions. That's not all. You can even swap the point of view from one shoulder to the other shoulder when you're in third-person. Certainly not bad. That's actually dope. When considering that such an option is often absent in many third-person shooters. Yes. Yes. Let's take a look at this. Let me know that's too loud still, okay? Popped off. Dude, how is this dude with no helmet? Been shot like 4 or 5 times now and he's fine. But he's killing people with one shot, you know what I mean? They just stand there. Are you kidding me? They just stand there. What? Okay. I mean, some of what I saw looked really cool, but I have concerns, man. It's really weird that, like, every time you come across an enemy, the enemy just, like, sits there and looks at you for a long time, giving you ample opportunity to just, like, do whatever you want. That was really weird. And, like, where your character can just sit there and just, like, pop off shots nonstop. It was, like, the enemy was, like, taking one shot. And then, like, 2 seconds between each other shot they were taking. That's weird whenever you're playing a game where it just doesn't seem like your enemies have the same kind of capabilities that you do. I don't know. Oh, no, you're fine, Kayla. I just said hi. I was just asking how you're doing. Quantum Air doesn't yet have a release date, but it kills me whenever I see people write like this. Quantum Air doesn't yet have a release date just yet. So, in other words, Quantum Air doesn't have a release date just yet. But it should come this year for PS5, PS4, and Xbox Series X and S. If you'd like to see more, you can enjoy a previous gameplay trailer, another teasing, a recently revealed environment, and one showing a cinematic from the beginning of the game. The game is a first-person shooter, and it was originally announced for PS5 and PS4 in early 2020. Platforms have been since expanded to include Xbox Series X and S, developed by Unreal Engine 5 by a small team based in Kalispell. What is MT, dude? Help out the pleb. I'm all right. I'm still just trying to shake the end of this, like, sickness a little bit. But, I mean, I could definitely be worse. Thanks for asking. It's always nice being here with you guys, you know. Founded by four brothers in 2016, the team previously released Kings of Lorne, Fall of Ibris in 2019. If you're unfamiliar with Quantum Air, you can check out an official description of the story below. I'll let you guys read that. I'll link it. I'll read it. Whatever. When the Monad Quantum Research Facility, 30 miles off the shore of California, is attacked by an unknown entity, engulfing the complex in flames and putting it into a full containment lockdown, a distress call is sent for mutual aid to the Gamboa Fire Department in San Francisco, California. Garboa. Fire Chief Sturgis answers the call and sends you, Captain Jacob Thomas, your partner Shane Costa, and a crew by helicopter to the Monad facility. Your mission is simple: save as many lives from the burning complex as possible and get out. However, that starts as a rescue mission quickly. What starts as a rescue mission quickly plummets into darkness when you arrive and find that things are not as they appear. Okay. I don't know. The game looked pretty cool, but I don't know. Like, you open a door and there are three enemies there, and they just give you, like, 3 to 4 seconds to, like, chill and be like, oh, hey, there's enemies. What do I want to do? You know, that was kind of odd. But here you go. If you guys want more. Rainbow Six Siege reveals Season 1 for Year 8. New operator and features. Today, Ubisoft reveals the first season of the 8th year of Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege, including plenty of news. The new season, which was teased yesterday, is titled Operation Commanding Force. Will start on March 7th. The main dish on the menu is a new operator from Brazil, Brava, who happens to be Capitão's cousin. Her gadget, the Clutch Drone, allows her to hack other operators' gadgets and turn them against them. 1 second. Apologies. So, a new anti-cheat feature named Mousetrap will try to detect input spoofing devices that let players on consoles use keyboard and mouse. It will apply a dynamic input lag to those detected to level the playing field and force players to switch back to the controllers. This shouldn't affect disabled players by adaptive controllers. The code of conduct will also be updated to explicitly disallow third-party spoofing devices. Okay. That being said, this is not the final iteration of the system, as it's something new the developers are trying, so it's still experimental. New anti-toxicity measures will also automatically mute the worst repeat offenders for a bunch of matches, requiring their teammates to unmute them manually if they want to hear them. Balancing changes bring the removal of reload canceling and more, while the onboarding experience for new players will be improved with the beginner's challenges. Of course, we also hear about the inevitable battle pass. Below, you can check out a cinematic trailer, another showing off Brava's gameplay, and a video with all the new details.
Prepare all you want. At the end of the day, I'm in control.
Okay, so they're actually showing it off today, if you didn't just see that. Look, they're going to do the year eight reveal today on their Twitch channel. So, if you're super interested, I don't know what time that's kicking off, but I'm sure the VOD will be there as well. So, if you're interested in this game and you're interested in more of what's to come for the new season, then that's going to be popping off today at some point. Watch this one too real quick. No, that's 6 minutes. We won't. But I'll link this for you guys. Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege has been out for a while, and unlike its successor, Rainbow Six Extraction, it has enjoyed great popularity among fans despite the slow start, contributing very consistently to Ubisoft's earnings. The game is currently available for PC, PS4, Xbox One, PlayStation 5, and Xbox Series X and S. Yo, okay, Kaylee. Yeah. I hope work goes well. Thanks. Thanks for stopping in, Frindo. Yep. Here you go, guys. Bam. If you want some more of those videos and stuff. Pokemon Scarlet and Violet leak reveals unused content. Test, test. Test, test. We good now? Okay. There we go. Solid. Gabs, what's up? Thanks, gamer. Appreciate it, buddy. My mic came unplugged, man. Yeah. My cable got caught on something whenever I moved it a little bit. I didn't realize it and it came unplugged. We should be good now, though. You guys good? Yeah, yeah. Test, 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 test. Yeah. Oh, well, I was reading an article, man. I moved my mic a little bit. My mic came unplugged and I didn't realize it. So I plugged it back in and then I had to reconfigure some software there to get my mic working again after the I plugged it back in. So apologies, gamer. Thanks for letting me know, man, that you couldn't hear my voice there, man. Gabs, what's up? Start this over. How about that? Okay. What you need to know about this article? Was I getting any of this in? Was I getting any of this in before my mic cut out? I hope so. Basically, TLDR, there's a bunch of content in Pokemon Scarlet and Violet that has been data mined. That didn't make it into the game officially. So it's like actually part of the game, but you can't access it as part of playing the game. So some people have found it within the game, but it's just like content that's in there that's like not normally accessible, right? So there's some different thoughts about what this is. This could be content that was maybe supposed to be part of the game at one point, but it didn't get finished before the game officially released. So it just kind of got stuck in some files as assets that weren't used whenever the game released. And it was just, it's still there, but you just can't normally find it. Or it could be content that's just waiting to be utilized as part of some DLC content later on. Things like that, right? But they have some links to see the stuff right here. Like that one right there. And this one as well, currently in the train. Word up. It's good to see you, Gabs. Happy Sunday. How was your visit with your aunt? Was it good? So here's some more of the stuff. There's a little video right here. I'm not going to watch this, but I'll let you guys watch it if you want. It's just going to showcase some of these assets that didn't make it into the full game that they've found at this point, right? At the moment of publishing, Nintendo and Game Freak have not addressed any of the speculation these tweets have created. We don't expect this will change as neither comments on speculation. However, if either does or any individual involved with either does, we'll be sure to update the story accordingly. Cool. But I'll link this in here if anybody wants to take a look. Cool. Gamer, thanks much, buddy. Yeah. Yeah. I didn't realize the slack on my cable for my mic had gotten so tight like a tiger, but I made sure we got plenty of slack in there now. It shouldn't happen again, hopefully, as I move the mic around. My cousin is like, oh, gross. Gross. You know what that reminds me of? whenever I was younger, I was probably like still single digits. But I was probably close to being around 10, something like that. So I was probably like 8, 9, 10 years old, something. My dad had a really good friend that he hadn't seen in a long time that came home to visit. And he had a kid. He had a couple of boys around my age. And they came to our house to visit. And one of them kept running down the hall and punching me. And I went and told my dad, you know. I was like, dude. Dad, this kid keeps running down the hall and punching me, you know? And he's like, okay. I was like, what do I do? He's like, punch him back. punch him back. Punch him right in the stomach, right here below his rib cage. Punch him hard as you can. He's like, if you get him in the right spot, he won't hit you anymore. Sure enough, dude, that kid came running down the hallway again, dude, getting ready to punch me. And, bro, I smacked him right there in the diaphragm. Like, bro, knocked the air out of him. And that kid never came at me again. Yeah. Yeah. But that was my dad, dude. My dad was all about, like, yo, you know, if somebody's messing with you, protect yourself, you know? It's like, if you get in trouble for it, I'll take care of it. You know, that was my dad's, like, methodology about handling yourself. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I'll never forget, like, dude, whenever I was in, like, fifth grade, it was the first time I ever got into a fight. Whenever I was in about fifth grade, we're getting off track here with video gaming news for a second, but whenever I was in about fifth grade, and see, it was a lot different for me than it was for my dad too, though. My dad's a really big guy. So my dad didn't have to deal with people messing with him very much, you know? I mean, my dad is a twin too, and they're both really big. They're like both about, you know, 6'2", 230, 240 as juniors in high school. They're big, big guys, you know? And for me, man, I was always a really little guy. Until, like, after high school, I finally grew. I'm still not as big as my dad ever was or is, you know, but I'm not, like, a little dude anymore. And, but I had to deal with people, like, trying to mess with me and pick on me and stuff because I was a little guy. But my dad was like, dude, like, fifth grade, one day, you know, there's, like, recess from school. You know, we had recess out on the playground. All of us guys were always out there playing like football together and stuff. Well, I got into it with this other kid on the football, you know, in recess on the playground playing football. And he came up and shoved me, you know, and I didn't really know what to do because I didn't want to get in trouble, right? And I went home and told my dad. I was like, dude, this is what happened. You know, Nick shoved me. You know, I grew up with all these guys. You know, I grew up in the same place like my whole life. I left as a young adult, never went back, but I grew up with all these guys too. So it's like, you know, Nick shoved me, you know, this is what happened to it. My dad's like, look, man, if somebody comes at you and they start instigating a fight or whatever, he's like, pop them in the nose. he's like, don't let them get the first shot on you. He's like, don't let them get the first shot on you. He's like, pop them in the nose hard as you can. And he's like, their eyes will water up so much they won't be able to see. He's like, and then if you need to finish the job, you finish the job. Most time it'll be done right there, you know? I was like, all right. And dude, no kidding, like within the next week, it happened again out on the playground. You know, some other dude, a big, big dude. Funny enough, I ran into this guy. We keep in touch. This is the first guy I ever got in a fight with. The first guy I ever got in a fight with is a guy I grew up with, dude. We're good friends still. He's a good dude. But he, you know, he ran up to me on the playground, got in my face because of some kind of football thing. We were playing football and he got pissed and got in my face. He shoved me in my chest, dude. And I just cocked back, dude, and just popped him right in the nose. I popped him right in the nose, broke his glasses, dude. And my dad was absolutely right, man. He was like, kid just started crying and like, you know, it was over with, man. That was it. It was over with, you know. But that was that was a big deal for me growing up whenever I was young because it was like, you know, a lot of times you just show people that you got a little bit of gumption to you and you're willing to stand up for yourself. People don't really mess with you anymore, you know? Bully? Nah, dude. You should have seen how little I was, bro. People were always trying to pick on me and bully me and stuff, dude. You know, because I was a little bitty guy. I was really little, you know? And but that was my dad. That was my dad's that was my dad's teaching. And my dad was cool. My dad was funny. He was chill. He was pretty laid back. My dad was apparently a pretty gnarly guy back when he was younger, you know, but that was my dad. My, like, if I ever had like, it, that was my dad's like teachings to me when I was young. He's like, if people start crap with you, he's like, finish it. Don't let them get over on you, you know? Breaking glasses, man. Dude, what's funny is like the very next day, dude, so we both got in trouble, right? Me and the kid, you know, we got in the fight or whatever. We both got in trouble. We're still friends, dude. I just saw him when I went home. He's like one of the only people that I'll go hang out with still from back home. And he's an awesome dude, man. We've stayed friends forever. But what's funny about it, this is the difference I think a lot of times between, you know, like I don't like to like genderize people and stereotype genders and stuff like that. But dude, quite often the difference between like guys and girls or men and women and stuff, when they fight, women tend to hold grudges, dude, from what I've seen between women. Dudes, it's like, bro, you fight it out and you'll be cool. It's over. It's squashed, man. It's done. But women seem to hold grudges. The very next day, dude, after the fight, after I punched this dude, we're hanging out on the, like, neither one of us could play on the playground anymore. So we're just chilling together, like looking at baseball and football cards and stuff. It was done, dude. It was over. It was squash. It was like, whatever. It was done. You know what I mean? Bro, you better put those things away then. You better put them away, dog, whenever I come to visit. I'm going to snap them, bro. I'm going to yoink them off your face. I'm just going to crush them, dude. I'm just going to crush them. I'm going to sprinkle them like that. Karate chop them bullies, dog. Hold grudges and ponytails. Yeah, I mean, it does seem like that quite often. Not all. I mean, and I don't like to stereotype people. I don't like to stereotype any group of people or whatever, you know what I mean? Because I've known, like, ladies that weren't like that too, you know? But it seems more often than not, you know, I've known a lot of ladies that were all about holding some grudges, dude. All about holding some grudges. We gonna get your cap? Yeah, I know. Burn it. I'm gonna snap his glasses. He's gonna yoink my hat off and burn it. And then you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna hug it out. It's gonna be fine. It'll all be over with. You know? It'll be all right. Then we're just gonna dress up in our Dumb and Dumber tuxedos and go hop in the Shaggy Dog car, and it'll be good, dude. Shut up. You guys are wild. It's funny, I haven't talked about that. I haven't thought about that in a long time, you know. But that was my dad's jam, dude. He was like, he wasn't necessarily like trying to teach me to go start stuff with people, you know, but it was definitely about like making sure that you weren't going to let people get over on you, you know. He didn't want us letting people think that they were going to be able to like get over on us and bully us and stuff. He wanted us to be strong, and I don't think anybody's ever going to go through life not taking a beating. I've taken a beating. Straight up. It happens, man. But showing people that you got a little bit of some guts to you, dude, and you're willing to like at least fight and stand up for yourself, I think goes a long way. No, oh, is that right, Wick? Is that right, Mr. Tutorial? you got beat by Hollow Knight, dog. What are you talking about? yeah, dude. Yeah, I mean, you know, that's what happens quite often in here, though. We'll get back into the news now, but it just, dude, as soon as you said that about your cousin, it just reminded me. bro. It just reminded me of that. That kid, dude, my dad's friend's kid running down the hall and, like, punching me, man. And I just didn't know what to do. You know, I had no idea what to do. That was like my first interaction with somebody that was like trying to incite violence on me, you know? I just went in there to my dad. My dad's like hanging out with the kid's dad too. My dad was like punching. His dad didn't care one bit, dude. So I did it, dude. I just did it. Let's get back in it, man. That's crazy, man. The life and times of OA, man. The life and times of OA. Shout out to my buddy, though. We'll call him C. My buddy C. He's a good dude, man. I just saw him whenever I was back home. And he's a solid bro. He's a solid dude. I don't talk to him or see him very often, but I always try to get in touch with him every once in a while and say what's up. He's a good person, man. Here are 5 hours of leaked gameplay footage from Atomic Heart. My buddy C is the dude that I got in a fight with back in elementary school. He's a good dude. Atomic Heart releases next week, and it appears that somebody has broken its review embargo, live streaming 5 hours of gameplay footage from it. Now, I'm certain that Focus Entertainment will soon take this video down, so be sure to watch it while you still can. Since the following video packs 5 whole hours of gameplay, it will spoil some things. As such, consider this your spoiler warning. Furthermore, as always, we won't allow spoilers in the comment section. Atomic Heart is an action first-person shooter set in the alternative retro-future versions of the 1950s USSR. The game will support real-time ray tracing effects, and PC gamers can download an older RTX tech demo for it. As we've already reported, the game will be using Denuvo anti-tamper tech, which usually jacks games up. So get ready for that. Thankfully, at least for RTX 4000 series owners, Atomic Heart will also support NVIDIA DLSS 3 at launch. Focus Entertainment will release Atomic Heart on February 21st, 2023. The publisher has not provided us with a review code, so don't expect a day one PC performance analysis. However, we've already purchased the game, so we'll be sharing our initial performance impressions on its launch day. Is this the... yeah, this is the five-hour gameplay video, okay? That's the five-hour gameplay video. If you want to watch it, I'll link it for you guys. I'm not going to watch it because it's probably going to get DMCA'd, you know? And I don't necessarily want spoilers in case we end up playing this at some point in the future. This is my thing, though. This is what I've been saying about Atomic Heart. This game's been delayed a number of times. Some of the gameplay I've seen looks very, very cool. But my advice here is to maybe, like, chill out. Wait until this game comes out, until we get some reviews. Especially depending on what platform you want to play it on. Get some reviews. Let some reviews pop out on whatever platform that you're going to plan on playing this on yourself before you decide whether you want to put money into buying this or not. But if you have Game Pass, it is hitting Game Pass day one. So if you're really adamant about playing and you have Game Pass, go for it, you know? But there's been delays. There have been some indicators that there might be some issues with this game. And I would just advise people to maybe temper your expectations a little bit. Hold off on just jumping in day one if you're going to be buying it outright, and just wait on some reviews so you don't end up feeling cheated out of your money a little bit if it does, in fact, end up not being fantastic, performance-wise or content-wise, whatever, you know? That link's there in chat, though. Agreed. I never want to say something can't be worse than something else. Ugh. Unfortunately, but, you know, hopefully not. The new Lord of the Rings games teased. Embracer Group, the new, we've talked about this a little bit here recently. We know roughly like 3 or 4 of these games that are coming, but there's like maybe 1 or 2 that we're not real knowledgeable about right now. Probably the closest coming to us is like Gollum. Embracer Group, the new owners of the Lord of the Rings IP as of last year, has announced that 5 different Lord of the Rings games are releasing between now and the end of 2024. Ultimately, it does not provide any further details on what these games are, nor shown any of them off. That said, Embracer Group did seem to hint at a combination of both internal studios under its umbrella and external partners working on said games. Noting specifically that the IP has generated a lot of interest among both internal and external partners for the Lord of the Rings IP across different media formats. All of this was shared during Embracer Group's latest earnings call with the investors. And while we don't know what some of these mystery games are, it's safe to assume one of them is The Lord of the Rings Gollum, considering it's slated to release sometime this year. Being developed by Daedalic Entertainment, the game was announced all the way back in 2019. It was supposed to originally release in 2021 before being delayed till last year, and now to this year at some point. Right now, it doesn't have a date beyond the very vague window of sometime this year. When it does release, it's supposed to do so via Switch, PC, PS4, PS5, Xbox One, Xbox Series X and S, all right? If you haven't seen the trailer, let's watch it real quick. It's been a while.
Something calls us Gollum.
What is it, Precious?
The Precious, of course. The Precious. We want it. We want it.
All right, Gabs.
Stay in the shadows.
Yo, thanks for being the catalyst behind me thinking about some old stories and stuff. Maybe we'll see you later.
Get to higher ground.
Be safe. Be safe. Honestly, I mean, there's a lot of stuff in the trailer even that I see that looks kind of janky, man. It's a little bit concerning. And while I've been psyched about this game and I think the premise behind it is very cool. Excuse me. Dude, there's been a number of delays in this game too, which, you know, is just one of those big glaring things that I think it should make people very, very weary about diving into a game day one. If you see multiple delays on a game, it usually means that there's something not so great going on in the development process. There's two sides to delays, right? Delays are good. We would much rather have delays for games than have games come out in a terrible state, such as, like, you know, Cyberpunk or, you know, No Man's Sky, something like that. So delays are warranted, and they are a great thing for developers to understand that they have our blessing to be able to utilize delays to an extent, right? But there's a flip side to this where it seems like I'm getting about 90% of the time when a game has numerous delays, it's a pretty good indicator there's some not so good stuff going on in the development process, and usually the game ends up having some not so good, a not great reception on release, whether it be for the content it's providing, the performance of the game. Across the board, there are some things that end up not being great about it. So it's not always, it's not tried and true, but I think it's something that should at least worry people enough that they hold up on just diving into the game on, like, pre-orders or buying it day one or anything like that, to where they give it a few days to come out and get a good idea of what the game has to offer before you decide whether it's worth your money or not, you know? How to play Diablo 4 beta early. We got some great news regarding the two upcoming betas for Diablo 4. The betas will run for 2 weekends, March 17th through the 19th and March 24th through the 26th. The first weekend will be early access only, while the second weekend will be completely open. Players wishing to play in the early beta must pre-order Diablo 4 to gain access. Ugh, gross. You can find full details, including the announcement cinematic, below. We saw this yesterday. I mean, as notable as Blizzard is for their cinematics, I was not super impressed with the cinematic. We'll watch it. Like, back in the day, Blizzard used to be just notorious, dude, for blowing people away with their cinematics. A refuge. I think they still do good ones. This one, I was like...
Instead, it became a new battleground in this eternal conflict.
I just wasn't seeing it. It didn't seem like Blizzard quality. Called the Haradrim. But what does anymore?
Am I right, chat?
But now this once powerful order
is
a husk of what it was. And Sanctuary's ancient creators have returned.
They just want you to have a phone and have plenty of well money to pay for things, you know what I'm saying?
This is the story of their downfall.
Too soon? That looks like a Blizzard to me. Yeah, you're not wrong, dude. Nice. Well played, sir. Well played. I wouldn't break your glasses either. You little snack. What is this? What do you think it is, dude? What are we just talking about? Are you not listening to me? You nailed it, Doug. You nailed it. Yeah, that's it. That's it, brother. Excuse me. Roach? That's what they should have done to Roach in Witcher 3, by the way. They should have just killed him off and not let you have a mount. The game would have been better off. What is this? Dude, what do you mean? What is this? What's the article we were just talking about? Why are you not listening to me? Why do you not pay attention to me, dude? Diablo 4, bro. No idea. We saw it yesterday, actually. Oh, you're driving? Oh, okay. We saw it yesterday during IGN FanFest, and I was like, dude, this is... Yeah, I was like, this is a Diablo trailer? Yeah, so there you go. That was like their beta announcement trailer or whatever. It was not very good as far as, you know, I was concerned. Yesterday at IGN FanFest, Blizzard revealed the first look at the opening in-game. That's the opening in-game cinematic, by the way. That's not just a reveal trailer for the beta. That is the opening in-game cinematic of Diablo 4. Blizzard has fallen off, dog. Alongside our upcoming early access and open beta weekend dates, beginning in March, players will be able to experience Diablo 4 during the two beta weekends available on Windows PC, Xbox Series X and S, Xbox One, PlayStation 5, and PlayStation 4. For those that pre-ordered Diablo 4, early access to the open beta will be from March 17th to March 19th, and code redemption is live now. On the following weekend, the open beta weekend will be available to everyone from March 24th to the 26th. Yeah, dude. For the open beta weekends, players will be able to experience a deep look into the early game, including the prologue and the entirety of Act 1 with a level cap of 25.
We'll be sharing much more information about the specifics of the open beta in the coming weeks. Check out the Diablo blog for continued updates, and be sure to tune in to our next developer live stream on February 28th, where we'll be covering open beta details and more. That was terrible, dude, as far as I'm concerned. They have some other good trailers that look nice for Diablo 4, but, dude, that's the opening in-game cinematic? Are you flipping kidding me? That was pretty terrible. Not just like content wise, but like it did not look good. Here, if you guys need it here. Blizzard has just, God, what happened to them, dude? The PlayStation goggles are a win for gamers, not for the metaverse. the metaverse. Will a fantasy where our office meetings and social gatherings take place mostly in a virtual reality ever come true? As a tech critic, bro, this is a long article. Hold on. TLDR, dude. I'll let you guys read all this if you want. I'm gonna try to TLDR this for us, though. Topics of the article here are: VR has yet to find a truly killer app. Headsets still look and feel weird to wear. The metaverse is lonely. Basically, their conclusion here, maybe one day when the tech is cheaper, has a truly killer app, and doesn't make people look like weirdos, we'll all hang out in the metaverse. For now, I'll continue to meet folks in person and online the old school way. Yeah, they've got a long ways to go. Look, I mean, there are good applications for VR. I talk about it a lot. You know what I mean? VR absolutely has applications even outside of gaming that are being very, very good for people. Whether it be like giving people the ability to look at a space virtually across the world in a different, you know, a completely different geographical location, or, you know, to be able to practice certain maybe athletic competitive sports or whatever while you're, you know, not in an area that you could normally do that, like, there are a lot of VR applications that are being utilized to help train athletes for, like, maybe, say, from golf to, like, baseball, all kinds of stuff. But, I mean, you think about the potential of, I've seen it also be utilized for things like snowboard sports or ski sports, things like that, winter sports, right, where you're not always in a location to be able to utilize a mountain or whatever, right? But they have, like, the VR set up. They've got tracks set up where you can strap into the gear, and it simulates that environment for you very well. So even outside of the metaverse or whatever you want to call it, and gaming, there's a lot of applicable uses for VR, and it's evolving. But I agree. I mean, I think that right now the technology, while it continues to evolve slowly, at some point we'll get there, man. But right now, yeah, it's like bulky, it's cumbersome, it's not great. I think the best way you can actually utilize a VR set is to get like a VR stand to strap into as well, where you've got like the platform that runs underneath you and stuff. You can hold you in place. It rotates you around. You don't have to worry about bumping into walls or breaking things in your living space, things of that nature, you know. But it, I mean, even outside of that, that's still a big piece of equipment that you're having to get into every time.
the equipment that you're having to put on is really bulky and stuff. So I don't know, man. We'll get there at some point, but I agree with this. If you guys want to read all of it, I'll link it in here for you. New Pokemon Mystery Dungeon game for Switch sounds like a perfect spinoff because Pokemon needs a new game every 5 to 6 months. You know what I'm saying? Who can keep up with this, dude? Pokemon Day will likely lead to several new announcements, one of which could be the return of one of Pokemon's beloved spinoff series. Pokemon Mystery Dungeon could be on the verge of its first installment in years, according to a new leak, which could be a perfect fit for the Switch. With how much time has passed since the last game, reintroducing players to Pokemon Mystery Dungeon could be a great move for the series. It was a formula that worked in the past, and the same approach could easily work on the Switch. Pokemon Mystery Dungeon is one of the more prominent spinoffs of the Pokemon series. Taking place in a world where Pokemon create their own societies without humans, Mystery Dungeon games are roguelite dungeon crawlers that mix traditional Pokemon mechanics into the spinoff series. The first few games is in the shook-up... What? The first few games in the shook-up the franchise's usual formula... I think this is written wrong. First few games shook up the franchise's usual formula with fun yet challenging gameplay and interesting stories, and it's disappointing that the spinoff has been dormant for so long. After a Pokemon survey hinted at a Mystery Dungeon return, it's worth hoping for a new game on the horizon, especially after Scarlet and Violet's innovations. Why it seems likely. February 27th is Pokemon Day. Fans are expecting to hear some announcement regarding plans for the series' near future. One thing could already be hinting towards one such announcement, though. As reported by comicbook.com, the Pokemon Together website designed for the occasion has a copyright for Spike Chunsoft hidden in its code. Spike Chunsoft was the team behind the Pokemon Mystery Dungeon games. It has not been involved with any other Pokemon titles, thus giving good reason to think that a new Pokemon Mystery Dungeon game may be announced soon, despite Pokemon Mystery Dungeon's Switch remake ultimately being underwhelming. It's needed, apparently. While the latest game in the series, Rescue Team DX, came out in 2020, it was just a remake of the original Pokemon Mystery Dungeons games. The most recent truly new game to come from the series is Super Mystery Dungeon, which came out in 2015. Not only has the current console generation not seen a new Pokemon Mystery Dungeon story, but at the time of Super Mystery Dungeon's release, the most recent Pokemon games were X and Y. No Pokemon that have debuted since Kalos have seen a Mystery Dungeon title, with some of the strongest generations of Pokemon games still being unaccounted for in the spinoff. Mystery Dungeon is one of the best Pokemon spinoffs, and it has been too long since it received a new installment. Revealing a new game in the series would likely be one of the biggest announcements that could come, that could be made on Pokemon Day. Spike Chunsoft has impressed more often than not with the game, so another Mystery Dungeon with even more Pokemon and moves would have a lot of potential. Reviving the series would be a great way to celebrate Pokemon Day 2023, with one of the few more exciting prospects being the reveal of a rumored Pokemon Scarlet and Violet DLC. Seeing another Pokemon Mystery Dungeon in the works would become one of the biggest pieces of gaming news for 2023 thus far. Not only would it be a major upcoming release for the Switch, it would drive interest for fans who love the old Mystery Dungeon games and have been waiting for a new game. Hopefully Pokemon's website is foreshadowing the impending announcement of the next Pokemon Mystery Dungeon. Let's see this. I'm not familiar with this. This is the 2015 game? Is that what this is?
Only to realize you've become a Pokemon. All you seem to remember is that you were once human. Why did you become a Pokemon? Your adventure to solve this mystery is about to begin. Pokemon Mystery Dungeon Rescue Team DX. Welcome to a world inhabited only by Pokemon. Upon arrival, you may not know up from down. Much less where you're going.
Got, like,
luckily,
back out on the
you'll
Switch
soon
or whatever,
meet a
right?
Pokemon with a big request.
I think so.
You see, Natural disasters have been occurring across the Pokémon world, but there's still hope, thanks to the heroic rescue teams. Now your rescue team must rise to the challenge by locating lost Pokémon and delivering food to those in need. It's an adventure that will take you far and wide, and may just reveal why you became a Pokémon in the first place. To rescue Pokémon, you must be prepared. If you're headed out, bring some items with you. Aurum Berries restore HP. Reviver Seeds will revive a fainted Pokémon. Slumber Orbs put opponents to sleep. And Empowerment Seeds power up Pokémon. In some cases, they'll even Mega Evolve. It may be tempting to bring a bunch with you, but you'll lose all your items if you're defeated in a dungeon. In other words, knowing which items to bring with you is of utmost importance to your rescue team.
I just got to where I couldn't keep up.
Choose wisely and commence rescue. Rescue teams journey deep within mystery dungeons. Somehow their layouts and item arrangements change each time you enter. Dungeons are inhabited by many Pokémon looking to battle.
Is that a ponytail?
Your attacks will be super effective if your Pokémon's type has the advantage over your enemies.
I just need a Haunter, dude.
Through battle, you'll level up. You'll become stronger, and you may learn some new moves, too. Plus, you'll learn useful capabilities, known as rare qualities.
I'm just gonna get a Haunter tattooed with Forge all the way across a path, my neck.
You can tunnel through walls. And with Wary Walk, you can disable any traps that come your way. It's your adventure, so make sure you have the advantage. Sometimes, even opponents can become friends. You can welcome up to 8 Pokémon onto your rescue team. The more, the mightier. Watch out now. This is a monster house. They're full of opponents.
Holy crap.
Stay vigilant, and you may just overcome the odds.
This does look cool though, man. It's got like the whole like tactics kind of
turn-based stuff to the Pokémon. Find the Pokémon you're looking for, and your mission is complete.
Cool.
Across the land, many beloved Pokémon are just waiting to be rescued. This is a story about the bonds forged between Pokémon, including you. Pokémon Mystery Dungeon, Rescue Team DX. Free demo version available now.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I wasn't really familiar with that, so... Cool. Yeah, we'll see what happens, dude. What, February 27th, is that when Pokemon Day is? Is that what they said? Yeah, February 27th is Pokemon Day, right? So we're pretty close. We're like a week away, just over a week away. We'll see what comes. Excuse me. Mamzelle, what's up, friendo? How are you? Ubisoft will reportedly revive a neglected franchise at E3. Yo. Is E3 actually going to happen? You guys believe that? What do you think? We already know that, like, again, Nintendo, PlayStation, Xbox, they've all said, no, we're not doing E3 anymore. And I already kind of called that. I knew they wouldn't. E3 is just not reliable enough. But Ubisoft's like, yeah, we're in. You know, So if E3 doesn't happen, when is Ubisoft going to be able to announce this, you know? You did a polar bear jump? For real? Dude, get wrecked. There's no way. E3 has to happen now, right? Right, because Ubi's going to be there, right? Nice, Mamzelle. Yeah, we read it on the internet. It has to be true. Ubisoft will reportedly be announcing an arrival of a neglected single-player series at this year's E3 Expo that might or might not happen, according to a report from Insider Gaming's Tom Henderson. News comes from Ubisoft's announcement earlier this week that it would attend this year's E3 that could or could not happen, as it hasn't happened for 3 years now, with a lot of things to show. After a rocky few years, E3 will finally maybe return to in-person events for the first time since 2019, because that's what they said they were going to do last year too, and they still canceled it. Although the likes of Microsoft, Sony, and Nintendo are rumored to be skipping the event, it's not a rumor, dude. They came out and announced it themselves. Ubisoft is the first major publisher to confirm its attendance. Skull... Yo, Skull and Bones has a secret improved version yet to be seen. It doesn't even have a released version. How is it going to have a secret improved version? What? Ubisoft has plenty in the pipeline that it could showcase at E3, even with a recent cancellation of three unannounced projects. Although it's anyone's guess as to what the company could show at the event, a new report from Insider Gaming has revealed exactly what the French video game publisher intends to show. The likes of Just Dance 2024, Assassin's Creed Mirage, of course, Skull and Bones, which is a myth. That game is not real. And the Crew Motorfest were all obvious guesses to appear at E3. But when it comes to surprises, Insider Gaming said, "We've been told that there is a single-player game planned to be announced for a neglected franchise." However, the report then goes on to state that, unfortunately, it's not Rayman. People will be a bit beat up about that. When it comes to the likes of Beyond Good and Evil 2, Splinter Cell Remake, Far Cry 7, and a Massive Entertainment Star Wars title, Insider Gaming strongly believes that these will all be announced at a later point. Dude, I don't believe this game will ever come out either. This is one of the longest games to ever be in development ever, ever, ever. Aside from Beyond Good and Evil 2, which was announced all the way back in 2017, the remaining titles are reportedly still in the very early stages of development. They should they still make an appearance at the year's E3, Insider Gaming believes it will simply be in the form of cinematic trailers. With so many titles in the works, Ubi has all the potential to steal the show at this year's E3 because nobody else gaming dev and publishing wise is going to go to E3 if it actually happens. However, many of the publishers' titles are yet to receive release dates, as the company is reportedly rather skittish in announcing release dates at the moment, likely due to Skull and Bones being delayed 6 times now after even having its own showcase in, like, what was it, September or October of last year? Titles such as Avatar Frontiers of Pandora, Assassin's Creed Mirage, and the Crew Motorfest are all slated to release this year, but none of them have exact dates attached just yet. E3 is slated to take place. They're saying E3 will take place. Dude, I do not believe it. E3 is slated to take place between June 13th and 16th in LA Convention Center. Aside from Ubi's confirmation of attendance, there has been no announcement of other participants because nobody believes it's actually going to happen. E3 has done this for the past 3 years where they go, "We're going to have an event," and then they cancel it. "We're going to have an event," and then we cancel it. And nobody can actually rely on the fact that they will, in fact, continue to have events. Not only that, but it just showed developers and publishers that they can do these summer showcases on their own now with their collaborators and stuff. They don't need E3 to do it anymore. E3 will never be the showcase that it ever was. It's too late, man. They screwed it up. Dead Rising 5 gameplay and details leak online. Dead Rising 5 gameplay has surfaced online. It gives us some insight into what the game could have been. The Dead Rising series was one of the most beloved zombie franchises in the late 2000s and early 2010s. Wait, you have videos of it? Really? Of doing a polar bear plunge? Really? Are you going to share it on the Discord? The Dead Rising series was one of the most beloved zombie franchises in the late 2000s and early 2010s. It took the novel concept of Dawn of the Dead's What if you were trapped in a mall with a zombie apocalypse and made it a whole game? Actually, two whole games, really. Given the mall is swarmed with zombies, you're left to fight them with otherwise everyday objects you'd find in a mall or make dangerous weapons out of them. Each game expanded in scope and scale, with the sequel being more of a small section of a casino resort before eventually encompassing entire cities in the following sequels. Unfortunately, the series began to lose its luster due to various reasons, resulting in the studio behind the series getting shut down. With that closure, Dead Rising 5 was also axed. However, we have some new footage and information on the game that shed some light on what we missed out on. Dead Rising 2 protagonist Chuck Green would have returned, possibly before the events of the second game, as he looks a bit younger. It appears that it would have been set in some kind of jungle, likely outside of the U.S., which would have been a first for the series. Players would have been able to find contextualized boxes to loot, as opposed to finding junk all over the ground, and had the opportunity to raid camps with many gangs, with enemy gangs, which would all lead up to the final boss. A portfolio showcasing level design and milestone presentation on Dead Rising 5 was found today by a community member, showing the game from 2017 running in Unreal Engine prior to being canceled. Interesting. Hopefully this won't get, like, DMCA'd or anything.
Yo!
Oh, dude. I've done Tough Mudders, and usually in Tough Mudders, they have a big, like, tanks in the middle of the obstacle that are filled with ice water, and it was brutal, man. Like, middle of summer doing Tough Mudders. Huh, weird. Yeah, so that was supposed to be Dead Rising 5, which, all this footage appears to be from 2017, so it would have likely been fairly early into development, as Dead Rising 4 was released at the end of 2016. Whether or not Capcom will ever bring back Dead Rising is a mystery. It seems like the company knows the franchise, franchises it wants to invest in, but reboots and remakes are a common practice these days, so it's anyone's guess. Wow. Hold on. Oh, you posted it? Oh, no. I got to see this. Oh, my God, dude. Oh, no. Oh, my God. Yo, that looks terrible. That looks terrible. Oh, my God. Dude is wearing a suit. That was awesome. Yo, thanks for posting this. That's great. That dude jumped in a suit. That was dope. Nice. Yo, good on you. That's sick. Thank you. Oh, dude, I can imagine. I can imagine. Yeah. What about Diablo 4, Wick? Oh, for real? Oh, that's sick. Yeah, dude, that's so cool that he jumped in his suit. That's awesome. Yo, ooh, polar bear plunge. That's one of those things. Dude, I don't like being cold. I like being cozy, man. So, I don't know. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how it's going to go with uploading this to YouTube with all that stuff we just watched for the Dead Rising stuff. So if all the video didn't get to be put up or we had to cut out a lot of the audio or whatever, sorry. Yeah, I don't know. It's an experience, yeah. Like I said, the closest I've ever been was like the Tough Mudder stuff, man. And that was enough for me, man. That was enough for me. Just diving in, how cold that water was, just being constantly refilled with like ice. It was a total shock, man. It was a total shock. Having to like, because what it was for the Tough Mudder, it was, they put an obstacle in it where you couldn't just like swim with your head above the water or whatever. You had to dive down underneath the obstacle as well. So it's like this big tub of water, ice water, and they're just constantly dumping more ice in it. So it's just filled with ice, dude. It's just filled with ice. And you have to like go in it, and you had to like dive underneath this obstacle and come out on the other side and then climb yourself out. And by the time you're like on the other side of this big giant like tub or whatever, and you've gone under and you've tried to like, your muscles are like, it's totally contracted, dude, and because they've gone from like being super hot too, man, like halfway through this obstacle course and running 6 miles already or whatever, because it's like a 13 miles in total, to just being totally frozen almost, you know, like your lungs can't breathe and you're trying to like climb your way out of the other side. It was crazy, dude. So I can't imagine like the polar bear stuff too. I bet that water was so cold. Thanks for sharing though. That's awesome. The new PlayStation freebie now available for PS4 and PS5 players. PlayStation has surprised PS4 and PS5 players with yet another freebie on PSN, this time courtesy of Horizon Forbidden West. It's a one-year anniversary. Wick, what about Diablo 4D? A sequel to 2017's Horizon Zero Dawn, Horizon Forbidden West from Guerrilla Games, was released on February 18th of last year. Exactly 1 year ago yesterday. So far, it's one of the biggest PlayStation releases this generation that more people would probably be talking about if it didn't release so close to Elden Ring and in the same year as God of War Ragnarok. Oh, yeah, I could see it. Yeah, I bet there was even more than you could see on the video. But, yeah, they kind of have to because there's the potential for somebody to go into such a mass amount of shock that they can't actually swim over. You know what I mean? Yo, random emote time. Oh, Kim likes Diablo. Yeah. Yeah. Man, Zell, we watched, there's a trailer out. We saw it yesterday during IGN FanFest, but Blizzard released like the opening cinematic. They showed the opening cinematic for Diablo 4. It's pretty underwhelming, if you ask me. It doesn't look very good. It's not the content. It's just the quality. It's just the quality of it does not look very good. We watched it again this morning right before you came in. It doesn't look to be the quality that you normally expect out of a cinematic from Blizzard, man. My opinion. Yeah, PlayStation has surprised PS4 and PS5 players with yet another freebie on PSN with Horizon Forbidden West. Yeah, we already knew this. We've kind of talked about this. Unfortunately, if you want to play the game, you need to pay for it. Other than those who have played it and are fans, PlayStation has a freebie for you. Wait, what are we talking about here? You're talking about the one with the trailer that has Lilith in it and everything? The trailer that has Lilith in it and everything looks great. But this is the actual opening in-game cinematic. Yeah, the Lilith video. The Lilith video is amazing, yeah. The Lilith video is great. And that's what I was saying. It was like, you know, Blizzard's kind of notorious for doing really, really good cinematics. They always have been. But, dude, this opening cinematic for the game is kind of gross looking, if you ask me. Here, I'll pull it up. I'll link it for you again. Did I link that before? Here, I'll just grab it. It should be easy. Jesus, are you for reals, dude? You probably find it here. This is it right here. I'll link it for you. Watch this. Let me know what you think. There you go. Anybody else that missed it too, there you go. We already knew Horizon Forbidden West was coming. PS Plus has got a lot of good games coming in, man. So as a thank you for 1 year of passion, support, and excitement about Horizon Forbidden West, we want to indulge you with a small token of appreciation in the form of new PlayStation avatars, which will be available, excuse me, to download from PlayStation Store tomorrow, which is today. Thank you again from the bottom of our hearts for embracing Aloy and her continued story in Horizon Forbidden West. We are now looking forward to our Burning Shores expansion coming to PS5 on April 19th, which sees Aloy pursue a sinister threat in the deadly volcanic ruins of Los Angeles. If you want to experience the world of Horizon from a completely different angle, Horizon Call of the Mountain is launching next week on PSVR 2. Yep, there you go. If you need more out of this, I'll link it for you. There's a lot of good games coming too. Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, for sure. There's a lot of good games coming to PS Plus right now. We've hit on a lot of them. Borderlands 3, Horizon Forbidden West. Dude, what else was it? There's a ton of stuff. We've hit on it the past few days. A bunch of them aren't coming, but there's a bunch of stuff. Dude, let's go. Danhausen thinks Def Jam Fight for New York should be remade and feature Eddie Kingston. Danhausen thinks Eddie Kingston would be the champion of in Def Jam Fight for New York. Def Jam Fight for New York is a 2004 video game released in the sequel to Def Jam Vendetta. The Def Jam Vendetta series featured popular rappers battling out using wrestling moves. Fight for New York took the wrestling ring away and focused primarily on rappers battling in more of a fight club setting. Danhausen thinks that Eddie Kingston would be perfect for this. While reacting to moves featured in Fight for New York on IGN FanFest, Danhausen called for a remake of the 2004 classic with Eddie Kingston, a Yonkers native featured. Def Jam Vendetta was born off the back of WCW closing in 2001. The original idea for Def Jam Vendetta was slated to be WCW Mayhem 2, with WCW once again having a game made with the AKI engine that is featured in games like WWF No Mercy. In 2003, AEW Fight Forever is slated to feature a gameplay engine heavily influenced by the AKI game engine that was popularized by the Nintendo 64 Nintendo 64 Classics. Recently, Kenny Omega explained why the game had been delayed due to its ESRB rating. Elsewhere during IGN FanFest, Zelina Vega discussed her ultimate crossover dream when it comes to pro wrestling and video games. Dude, I would love them to bring back a Def Jam game. Those were so good. They were so good. If you want like to watch the videos or whatever, then here you go. We saw it during FanFest, though. Steam Sale makes a bunch of games just $1. A new Steam Sale courtesy of Fanatical is giving a bunch of games and a collection of games away for just $1. The promotional sale is aptly called the Dollar Collection Sale, featuring bundles, packs, and more. That said, the sale is only available for a limited time, and each specific deal only while stocks last. In other words, by the time you're reading this, the sale may no longer be as robust as it is right now, or even still be available. This was yesterday, by the way, around noon Eastern. Get your hands on a massive selection of awesome bundles, packs, specials, editions, and more, all for $1 each. Reads an official blurb about the sale. Pack your cart full with a huge collection of gaming bundle goodness, including the Kingdom Wars Triple Pack, Commandos Collection, Sudden Strike Trilogy, Anomaly Complete Pack, Little Do 1 and Little Do 2 Plus Pack, Postal Paradise Pack, available for a limited time only while stocks last. As you can see, the deals featured aren't for the greatest, biggest, and newest games on Steam. They are for smaller indie games. That said, if any $1 for any of the games or bundles above interests you, or if you're interested in checking out the rest of the sale, click here. Since the deal went live, some games and bundles have already sold out, so be sure to check out the sale sooner rather than later and pull the trigger on if anything interests you sooner rather than later. Really? Twice? God, they're bad about that. For those that don't know, Fanatical is a verified third-party seller. It's not affiliated with Steam, but it is able to provide Steam codes, presumably because it acquires keys from publishers and developers en masse. It's able to offer some absurdly low prices for games. It runs promotional sales like this quite often. Fanatical, I can tell you that their keys have always worked for me. I haven't bought a massive amount of games off there or anything, but I have used them occasionally, and it's always been good for me for Steam keys. Here you go if you need this. Nintendo Switch sale makes over 30 games 99 cents each. A new Switch sale over on the eShop is offering 34 retro games for just $1 each. Every individual game included in the Capcom Arcade Second Stadium is available at half off, which means each game can be downloaded for just $1 a pop. This collection of games includes the likes of Street Fighter, Mega Man, and Echo Fighters. Special deals, all of which can be found at the link here, are only available until March 1st. If you're reading this on March 2nd or after, you missed out on the offer. Whether it will return in the future or not remains to be seen. There's no reason to expect this to be a one-off offer, but there's no guarantee it won't be. It includes the following games. ...1943 Kai, Black Tiger, Block Block, Capcom Sports Club, Darkstalkers, The Night Wars Darkstalkers, dude, I love that game. Eco Fighters, Gunsmoke, Hisatsu, Buraiken, Avengers, Hyper Dying Sidearms, Hyper Street Fighter 2, The Anniversary Edition, Knights of the Round, Last Duel, Magic Sword, Mega Man, The Power Battle, Mega Man 2, The Power Fighters, Night Warriors, Darkstalkers Revenge, Nikki's, Rally 2011 LED Storm, Saturday Night Slam Masters, Savage Bees, Sun Sun, Street Fighter Alpha, Warrior's Dream, Street Fighter Alpha 2, Street Fighter Alpha 3, Super Gym Fighter Mini Mix, Super Puzzle Fighter 2 Turbo, The King of Dragons, The Speed Rumbler, Russian Crash, Three Wonders, Tiger Road, and Vampire Savior. If you need it, there's links in there to go check out the eShop for those games, all right? Xbox Game Pass, this is the last article I have, guys. And then I'll talk about the game that I am, we're set to go play for just a second. And we'll get into some Once Human, which is that. Yeah. Yeah. Weird, right? Makes me wonder what the rest of the cinematics in-game are going to be like. Not the Blizzard we once knew. You know what I mean? Xbox Game Pass and Xbox Game Pass Ultimate subscribers are about to lose access to one of the biggest and most celebrated games series in gaming. The Game Pass library is constantly evolving, adding new releases. This is great news for most subscribers who prefer to play the latest releases, but it also means entire series, are sometimes added, removed, and then inaccessible via the subscription service. For example, at one point, Xbox Game Pass had several Final Fantasy games. Now it has one, and it's losing this final game. More specifically, alongside six other games, it's losing Final Fantasy XIII Lightning Returns on February 28th. Here's the E3 trailer. I'll let you guys watch it if you want, but the final Fantasy game that's on Xbox Game Pass right now is going away at the end of the month. So if you want to play it, you should go play it now. That's what you need to know, okay? It's the sequel to Final Fantasy XIII 2. Wraps the storyline of Final Fantasy XIII. Upon release, garnered middling reviews. If you're a fan of Final Fantasy XIII, it's a must-play for narrative reasons, okay? So, if you're interested, it's going to go away in, like, 9 days. So, go get your gameplay in. Yo, don't forget to get your free games. Game right now. War Pips is free on Epic. Till what? Roughly 4 days from now. And then Duskers will be available. All right? Don't forget to get your free games. Free games. That's what I got. Them's the breaks. Oh, man. We're going to move on to day two of our beta testing for Once Human. We had a nice little, like, 3 to 4 hour entry into the beta testing of the game yesterday. We should get a little bit more time into the beta today. We got through basically the main part of the game. It's kind of the tutorial, shows you how the game works. We're getting into the second part of understanding how we've just entered the open world of the game today. And we're going to be moving on to starting to create our base, starting to put into ability points, things of that nature. So far, the game feels pretty good, especially for a beta. I did not have time last night to look into getting an overlay set up. I might have to do that this morning before we start the game up, though. An overlay for frame rate and stuff. I need to try to maintain some kind of knowledge on what kind of frames I'm getting in the game, so I might have to incorporate that right now. We'll take a look real quick and see if I have something that I can boot up. But you guys are amazing. Thank you for being here, being a part of what we do all the time, and for being a part of this new segment specifically. If anybody is checking out this or any of the other content that we have as highlights on the Twitch channel or VODs on the YouTube channel, whether it be the new segments, the video game episodes of playthroughs we've done, or just funny, absurd highlights that we have of the good times that we have, then see what you can do about coming and hanging out with myself, the rest of this amazing community, whenever we go live at 6 a.m. CST every single day. We start off all of our streams with video gaming news before we dive into whatever content, why is my camera off? Whatever gaming content we have. There we go, that's a little bit better. Whatever gaming content we have slated for the rest of the day, okay? Other than that, you guys just stay healthy, stay safe, be kind. Have a great rest of your Sunday, great rest of your weekend. We will catch everybody tomorrow for February 20th edition of Video Gaming News. All right?